Hey everyone, in a previous video I discussed why you should usually not power a mid-range GPU with a single Devilspawn PCI Express cable, or a pigtail cable to use its proper name. And essentially that boils down to the fact that a single PCI Express cable can sometimes only deliver 150 watts of power through it, which isn't sufficient for many mid-range GPUs like my own AMD RX 6700 XT or the NVIDIA RTX 3070, well, the versions of it that still accept 8-pin connectors, I guess. Many of NVIDIA's recent cards actually use a different cable altogether, which is a topic I'll discuss a lot more later in this video. But I also want to discuss how you should ideally power higher-end cards that require up to 3 PCI Express connectors like the ASUS TUF version of the RX 7900 XTX. Do you really need an 850-watt power supply unit and 3 separate PCI Express cables like they recommend? Well, that's going to look really messy, especially if you call the pigtail ends. And whether you have a higher-end NVIDIA or AMD card, what should you do if your power supply unit simply doesn't support all of these new power requirements? Well, I'll answer all of these questions in this video, and I'll also point out where you can cut corners, and also where you definitely should not. So let's start at the beginning, because starting at the end would be confusing, I guess. This is a standard PCI Express cable, one that started to get popular just after the millennium, when the ATX 2.0 power standard started to get formalized. It can have 6 pins or 8 pins at the end, depending on what the actual PCI Express device needs. Some GPUs just need 8-pin connectors, some just need 6 pins, others might need a mix, like my RX 6700 XT, that needs one 8-pin connector and one 6-pin connector. When these cables first started coming out, which was more than 2 decades ago now, a 6-pin PCI Express cable would typically only provide 75 watts of power, especially if it was a cheaper gauge cable known as a 20 to 22 AWG cable, and an 8-pin variant would usually only provide 150 watts of power. Also, the ATX standards specify the motherboard PCI Express slot should supply 75 watts of power to plugged-in cards. All this means that if you were looking to power a low-range GPU that needed a single 6-pin cable, and I had a cheap PSU with cheap cables, this might only be supplying 150 watts of power in total, 75 watts of power from the motherboard, and then 75 watts more from the cable. This would naturally rise to 225 watts of power for an 8-pin card and cable, because this would be 150 watts. Hopefully that makes sense. So now I'm going to make one final point about low and mid-range cards, because it's really important to actually understand how we can properly power higher-end cards as a result. So what happens if a GPU needs multiple PCI Express connectors? For example, in the case of my own GPU that has a TDP of 230 watts. Well, since this requires a 6 and 8 pin connector, can I just use the horrible Devilspawn connector that Corsair gave me? I could plug one pin from this end, the 8 pin, and also use the 6 pin from this end, right? Well, this is where things get confusing. If I had a super budget PSU, then I probably would not be able to reliably power my RX 6700 XT card using the single Devilspawn cable, because it might max out at a total of 225 watts of power delivery, below my card's rated maximum. This would then result in crashes and freezes, or just general poor performance, especially in very demanding games that push my card's power use right to the edge. However, the reason I said that this is confusing is because a quality power supply unit will often supply better cables than the bare minimum 2-decade-old ATX specifications actually allow for. If I have 18 AWG cables or better, these can often supply up to 288 watts of power per cable, which isn't part of the ATX specifications, but is based on a safe calculation based on theoretical limits for these higher gauge cables. And as luck would have it, many PSU makers will actually list the cable gauges in the manual or online. And these PCI Express cables from Corsair are actually 18 AWG, so a single one of these could probably supply around 288 watts to my GPU, which is more than enough to cover its TDP. Class over. The theory side of things is done now, so we can specifically discuss how to actually power high-end graphics cards from both NVIDIA and AMD, like the RX 6900 XT or the 7900 XTX on the AMD side that has 3 PCI Express connectors, or many of NVIDIA's 3000 or 4000 series cards that require new cables entirely, like NVIDIA's proprietary 12-pin cables or the 16-pin cables that were introduced by Intel in the ATX 3.0 and 3.1 standards. So let's tackle older NVIDIA cards and all AMD graphics cards first, so that we can finally stop holding all of these like a madman. So when a card asks for 3 separate PCI Express connectors, it's very unlikely you'll actually need to run 3 separate PCI Express cables from your power supply unit. That's because the TDP of a card like the 6900 XT is 300 watts, and even the most budget PCI Express cables should be able to supply 150 watts each, meaning that having two separate cables will cover these power requirements. Not to mention that the motherboard's PCI Express slot will add a further 75 watts of power supply. Even the 7900 XTX only goes up to 355 watts. So in the case of AMD, you should be fine just to run two separate PCI Express cables from your power supply unit. And then for the third connector, you can just use the horrible pigtail connector to tick a box. Now, an electrical engineer might not agree with my word in there, but essentially, that's it. That's all you need to know. In other words, unless AMD brings out a much more power-hungry GPU, or you try to overclock your 7900 XTX card, you'll be fine with just two separate cables from your power supply unit. But this does have two downsides, of course. Not every PSU actually supports this, and also pigtail connectors look ugly, especially with loads of cables. But I'll cover these points later in the video. Now it's NVIDIA's turn. Because graphics cards have been getting so power-hungry and traditional PCI Express cables are a bit confusing, NVIDIA started rolling out a 12-pin cable for some of their 3000 series of GPU. This new cable was designed to deliver at least 400 watts of power, which is pretty impressive to be honest. And this cable had two standard PCI Express ends that would plug into your power supply unit. In other words, your PSU would need at least two free PCI Express slots to properly use the 12-pin cable. If you have a budget power supply unit with only one free PCI Express slot, then you're probably out of luck completely, but I'll discuss this point more later in this video. But assuming your PSU supported it, you then plug it in as normal and then connect a single 12-pin end to your NVIDIA card. And because that cable adapter was often included in the GPU box, this was a fairly straightforward process in most cases. Enter the 12-volt power connector. This 16-pin cable is part of the ATX 3.0 standards from Intel, and is designed to supply up to 600 watts of power, but it has a fundamental flaw. It melts. Well, not in every case, but this did have a lot of bad press because many people did actually discover that the cable connectors were melting, ruining the cable in the best case, and actually people's graphics cards in the worst case. But for NVIDIA's high-end 4000 series cards, you have no choice but to use a 16-pin cable. So the way these actually work is pretty much the same as the 12-pin cable I just discussed, to be honest. You have two PCI Express ends that plug into your power supply unit, and then you insert the full 16-pin end into your graphics card. But please make sure that you actually insert it all the way in with no gaps at all. That's part of the reason that the 12-volt power cables were actually melting in the first place. Well, that and also some teething issues with some third-party cables from companies like CableMod, who had to do a recall. But if you do have an ATX 3.0 PSU, like I have in my Home Lab NAS, or you simply went out and you purchased an official cable from your PSU maker, like buying a Corsair 12-volt cable directly from Corsair, not some random third-party, then you should be safe to power your high-end NVIDIA card just with one of these cables. Just plug two ends into your power supply unit and the other end into your graphics card. But if you still have concerns, that's where the ATX 3.1 standards come in, because they actually tweak the design of this connector a bit to have shorter sensing pins and also longer conductors inside, bringing about the 12V-12x6 connector, which isn't a very snappy name, but 12vh-pwr wasn't either, really. So what's worth noting is that this design doesn't really require you to go out and purchase brand new cables. The older 12-volt power connector cables are still fine. The changes made in the ATX 3.1 specifications are for the GPU connection end, not the cable design itself. So as long as you have one of these cables from an official source, in other words, not some random no-name supplier from AliExpress or eBay, then it will work fine, as long as it's properly inserted into the GPU slot all the way. But what should you do if your PSU simply doesn't support these? In other words, if you have a budget PSU that only has two PCI Express / CPU slots, how can you power your RTX 4090? Well, the answer is, you can't. If you do have a card that uses 375 watts of power, for example, then I would personally never try to come up with some smart solution that works with a single cable. It's just not worth it. The only exception here is if your card has a TDP rating of around 300 watts, and you have a 16 or 18 AWG PCI Express cable, because that cable should be able to supply 288 watts of power, and then the motherboard PCI Express slot should top this up to meet the card's power requirements with the 75 watts extra. But there's a lot of shoulds in there. I personally like to err on the side of caution and run multiple cables for any GPU with a TDP over 225 watts. But hopefully through watching this video, you now have all the facts and you can make an informed decision about what's best for you and your PC build. One downside of running multiple cables is that it does look a bit rubbish with the standard cables that come with your PSU, especially if they come with pigtail connectors and these split ends, because they just hang around your case and look a little bit terrible, to be honest. So there's two main solutions here. You can actually try zip tying the cable end to the rest of the cable and at least hide it a little bit. but you still then have the issue of these cables being quite big and bulky. What I prefer to do is go out and buy separate, individually sleeved cables, and you can get these from reputable companies like CableMod, but if your PSU maker sells them direct, then you should probably buy them from there, because that's even better. These cables look a lot nicer, and you can often opt for single-end cables. In other words, ones that don't have the horrible devil-spawn pigtail connector on the end, also called a Y-splitter end. This means that you can just plug this in with no pigtail end, and it does make your case look a lot better, a lot smarter. There are loads of different PSU cables, and if you wanted to learn more about what each of them does, then I have a full video guide that you can check out here, and I hope that you found this video useful. If you did, please click the thumbs up button, and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.